خيره وشره من الله والبعث بعد الموت لا إله إلا الله.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليمًا كثيرًا. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله تعالى وخير الهدى هدى محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. One of the most important characteristics and attributes of every single Muslim is that they must have high determination and high aspirations. In order to be a successful Muslim, not only do you need to have a lofty vision and goal and high aspirations, but you also need to be determined in achieving and attaining those aspirations. The Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said to us, me and you, Ala inna sil'atallahi ghaliya. Indeed, Allah is selling something. Allah wants to make a transaction with you. He wants to sell you something. He wants you to buy it from him. But what Allah is selling is very expensive. Very, very expensive. More expensive than the nicest car. More expensive than the nicest mansion or house. More expensive than anything else that you can think of. Ala inna sil'atallahi al-jannah. For indeed what Allah is selling, what Allah wants to give to you is Jannah. Allah wants to sell paradise to you. But in order for you to be able to buy paradise, you must pay its very expensive price. And so you must have high aspirations. But not only high aspirations, you must have high determination in order to be able to go and reach that goal of Jannah. And that's why a person came to Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal rahimahullah, the famous scholar of Islam, and he said to him, when can we rest in this life? As Muslims, when can we rest? And so Imam Ahmad said, you rest when you place your right foot inside of Jannah. That is when you rest. That is respite for you. Until your right foot enters into Jannah, you're firmly planted into Jannah, until then there is no rest. Because Shaitan doesn't sleep. Shaitan doesn't rest. Shaitan doesn't go on vacation, he has no holidays. Shaitan doesn't take a long weekend break. Shaitan works 24/7 every single day of every single year. And so in order to beat him, you must have that type of determination. The Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam was once with his companions and they entered into a graveyard. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam made dua for the people of the graveyard, as it is sunnah to do. And then he said out loud, I wish I would be able to meet my brothers. I wish that I can meet my brothers. So they said to him, the companions, O Messenger of Allah, are we not your brothers? He said, no. You are my companions. You are my companions. As for my brothers, then there are those people who will come after me, who have never seen me, nor have they heard me directly, nor did they ever meet with me. They come after me, yet they still believe in me. For them to hold on to this religion is like holding on to red hot coals. For one of them is the reward of 70. So they said, O Messenger of Allah, do you mean 70 from amongst them or 70 from amongst us, meaning the companions? And so he said, no, rather 70 from amongst you, from amongst the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. high determination. In order to get that goal, you need to hold on to red hot coals. Now I want you to imagine this. None of us, and this is the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it was not decreed for any of us that we lived in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. None of us are companions. Imagine how beautiful it would have been to sit alongside the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imagine how beautiful it would have been if the first thought that you had when you woke up in the morning was, I can't wait to lay my eyes upon the face of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imagine how beautiful it would have been to know that on that day your dinner would be alongside with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imagine how beautiful it would have been to pray a single prayer behind him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imagine how beautiful it would have been just to go and sit with him, listen to his words, hear him laugh, hear him cry, hear him speak to you. Imagine how beautiful it would have been if the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam performed your nikah. If the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the one who named your children. Imagine how beautiful it would have been. If you had a question about your religion, you didn't just go to a sheikh, you didn't just go to a mufti, you went to the one that Allah revealed the Quran upon. Your life revolved around the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Anything you wanted, anytime you wanted it, you would go and you would take solace, you would take peace from the company of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imagine how beautiful that would have been. Imagine what would you give just to have a single minute, a single second in the company of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But from the wisdom of Allah is that He didn't decree that for us. It wasn't decreed for me and you to be from amongst the companions. Yet from the mercy and the justice and the kindness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that even though in this life you never had that opportunity, you will have it on Yawmul Qiyamah. On Yawmul Qiyamah, you can be in the company of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So hope is not lost. For the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was asked by his companions, O Messenger of Allah, where will we see you on Yawmul Qiyamah? Where can we meet you? And he said, you will find me at the Hawd, at my pond, where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with his own blessed hand, will be drawing water from his pond, and he will be giving it to the believers so that they may drink. The water of that pond is whiter than milk. Its scent is sweeter than musk. Its taste is sweeter than honey. Whosoever drinks from it will never experience thirst again. This will be for the believers. May Allah grant us that blessing. So people will come on that day and they will take that water from the hand of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imagine the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam serving you. It would have been an honor. We would have spent everything that we owned, given up everything in this life, just to serve him a single cup of water. Yet for the honor of the believers on Yawmul Qiyamah is that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will serve you. He will serve you. You will not serve him. Yet there will be a group of people, my dear brothers and sisters, that will come on that day. People who are Muslims. Who are Muslims. They believe in La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. Yet as they come closer and closer to the pond, the angels will come and they will drive them away. Push them back. Imagine, after years of longing to meet the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam just once, to give him salams just once, to hug him just once, to kiss him just once, to speak to him just once. Imagine that the angels come and they push you away. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will call out and he will say, Ummati, Ummati. These are from my ummah, they are my people, let them come. And so the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will be told by the angels, you don't know what they did to your religion after your death. After you died, O Muhammad, they innovated, changed, twisted your religion. They made excuses to say this is halal or that is haram. They changed your religion for the ease of their own lives, to make things easy for themselves. And so the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam will say upon hearing that, suhqan suhqan liman baddala ba'di, take them away from me, remove them from me, distance them from me, those people who changed my religion after I died. Imagine how heartbroken you would feel. Not only are the angels pushing you back, but the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam himself absolves himself, he frees himself from you. He doesn't want to know you anymore. Why? Because you didn't stick to his religion, you didn't implement his religion, you didn't practice his religion as he legislated and as Allah legislated. So high determination. And part of high determination means that it's not easy. It's not an easy thing to achieve. High determinations, high aspirations, these are not just simply easy words. They are difficult to achieve and to attain. No one had it easy. No one that had high determination for the sake of Allah ever had it easy. Look at the example of the Prophet Nuh alayhi salam. 950 years he calls to Allah. Can you imagine that? Most of us, if you give da'wah for 10 minutes, we've like had it for the week or the month, right? That's it, we need a holiday. It's too much. Imagine 950 years, day in, day out, calling to Tawheed. And what do the people do? Do they accept? Does he have a big ummah? Does he conquer the whole of the earth? No. A handful of followers. Very few in number. After nearly 1,000 years of da'wah, a handful of people. Not only that, but his wife and his son disbelieve in him as well. They reject his message. They don't accept his message of Tawheed. His own wife and his own son. And so the Prophet Nuh alayhi salam, Allah Azza wa Jal made him from the greatest messengers of Allah, from the most great, from the greatest creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yet it was achieved through high determination. Look at the story of the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam, when he's calling his father and his own people. And his own father, can you imagine a person's own father condemning him to death? Not only to death, he wants him burned alive. The most severe, horrific manner of ever killing anyone. Burnt alive. And the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam is patient. He has high determination. He trusts in the promise of Allah. And so Allah saves him. And then finally, when he has a child, he's told to leave his child and his wife in a valley in which there's no food, no drink, not a single person living there. And he does it for the pleasure of Allah. And then when that child now grows old and is finally becoming a child, he has a personality, he's becoming a boy, Allah says, go and slaughter him. Sacrifice him. Kill him for my sake. And so the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam goes, and he was almost about to sacrifice him had Allah not saved his son Ismail alayhi salam. Look at the Prophet Musa alayhi salam. One man along with his brother asking that a group of people be freed from the most oppressive, tyrannical ruler that probably ever lived on the face of the earth. He has an army, he has wealth, he has power, he has authority. What does Musa have? A stick. Can you imagine? Allah Azza wa Jal says, go. He asks, oh Allah, what do I have? Allah says, take your stick. Yet he has high determination. He has that patience. He has that certainty in Allah. And he takes that stick. And with that stick, by the permission of Allah, he topples a whole country, a whole regime, a whole kingdom. Look at the example of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. That the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, despite how weak the Muslims were, despite how oppressed they were, The Prophet ﷺ said to his companions, by Allah, a time will come that there will not be a single house, neither in the east nor in the west, except that this religion will enter into it. Can you imagine at those humble beginnings, when there were just a few companions who were poor, slaves, weak, oppressed, and now the Prophet ﷺ is saying, you're going to conquer the Romans. You're going to conquer the Persians, the two superpowers of that time. Not only that, the whole earth will be filled with the message of Islam. Look at this high determination. And that's why when the Prophet ﷺ was once passing by a companion, and that companion was making dua for Jannah, and he was asking Allah for Jannah, and inside of that dua, he was asking for a lot of detail. Oh Allah, I want this type of house. Oh Allah, I want it designed in this way. Oh Allah, I want this type of color. Oh Allah, I want these types of bricks. Oh Allah, I want this type of jewelry. And he was going into detail upon detail upon detail. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, when he heard him, he said, إِذَا سَأَلْتُمُ اللَّهَ الْجَنَّةَ فَاسْأَلُوهُ الْفِرْدَوْسِ. If one of you wants to ask for Jannah, then ask for Firdaus. Don't ask for the bare minimum. Don't ask just to be entered into Jannah. Don't ask for all of the pleasures that you know are contained within Jannah. What do you ask for? Firdaus. And what is Firdaus? فَإِنَّهُ أَعْلَى الْجَنَّةِ وَأَوْسَطُ الْجَنَّةِ وَمِنْهَا تُفَجَّرُ أَنْهَارُ الْجَنَّةِ وَفَوْقَهُ عَرْشُ الرَّحْمَنِ. For indeed it is the highest part of Jannah, and it is in the middle of Jannah, and above it is the throne of Allah, and from it do all of the rivers of Jannah come. The Prophet ﷺ wants his ummah to have high aspirations. Each and every single one of us, he wants us to have high aspirations, so that even when we ask Allah for his reward, we ask for the best reward that he has, subhanahu wa ta'ala. We don't settle for second best in this ummah. But unfortunately, my dear brothers and sisters, this is something that we've lost. We've lost this. How many Muslims now have high aspirations? How many Muslims really want to make a difference? How many Muslims are willing to sacrifice their money and their time and their family for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Often you find that when you come to a Muslim organization, they're struggling for volunteers. They're struggling for money. They're struggling for resources. Why? Because we as a collective community, we as Muslims, no longer have high aspirations. Every person is nafsi nafsi. Just about me. It's just about my family. Just about my children. Just about my job. Just about my bank balance. This is how we think. Yet when we look at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam encouraged, nurtured, ingrained within his companions that they should have the highest aspirations. And that's why this small group of Muslims who were weak, ill-prepared, illiterate, uneducated, poor, oppressed, they became the rulers of the earth by the permission of Allah. They had those high aspirations. So the first thing that we need to do, my dear brothers and sisters, is have that vision and that goal. Our goal in this life, first and foremost, is to attain Firdaus. Every single minute of every single day, with every single breath, my goal is to achieve Firdaus, to achieve the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And can you imagine that if this was the way we brought up our children and our youngsters, how different would our community be? There was a young boy, two young boys. I will give you two different two different faces of the same coin. There was a young boy who came and he was complaining because he failed his exam. He failed one of his exams. And his parents became so angry that they shouted at him and they told him that he was lazy. They told him that he was a failure. They told him that he wouldn't go on to get a good job. He wouldn't have a career. He'd probably have to be a taxi driver or something, work in a factory. This is how they dealt with him. Can you imagine that this is what they said to that child? So how will that child now grow up to have high aspirations, not only for himself, but for his ummah, for his community? If that child was taught that the most important thing in this dunya is the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that no matter what happens in this dunya, everything is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and no matter how weak you are, no matter how uneducated you are, no matter how illiterate you may be, if Allah Azza wa Jal wills and you have that high determination and that vision for yourself, you can achieve the highest goals. And the proof of that is all around you. You only need to look at the multi-billionaires of today. How many of them are college dropouts? How many of them didn't even graduate? How many of them didn't come from a very prosperous background? But now they're the richest, most powerful people upon the face of the earth. That's one side. The other side of the story is another little boy that I know in our community. And this was last Ramadan when I came into the masjid. And as you know, that Ramadan, now Taraweeh prayer, is very late in the night. Right? We're in the summer, long days, short nights. Taraweeh starts around 10:30, 11 o'clock. I came into the masjid and I just happened to stand in Taraweeh next to a very young boy. Very young. He barely reached my knees. Like, he was just slightly above my knees. And I was amazed. I couldn't see his parents. He didn't look like he was with anyone. He was just standing on his own and he prayed all 8 rak'ahs. We pray 8 in our masjid. He prayed all 8 rak'ahs. And in our masjid every day, the imam reads 1 juz of the Quran. It's not like a 10-minute taraweeh. It is 1.5 hours. And he stood. I've seen adults, 10 times his age, 50, 60 years old, men 20, 30 years old, that after the first 2, they have to sit down and rest. They can't take it anymore. They have to go out for a drink of water. He prayed all 8. And I was amazed. So after the prayer finished, I asked him, you know, where's your father? He said, my father's at work. No, sorry, the first question I asked him was, how old are you? And he said he was 7. So then I asked him, where's your father? He said, my father's at work. He works nights. I said, who did you come with? He said, I came with my mother. Now obviously his mother is in the mother's section. She's on the sister's side. She's not standing with him. So who are you with in the men's section? He's on his own. And so I asked him, what do you want to be when you grow up? Can you imagine what his response was? Do you think he said a doctor? Do you think he said an accountant? Do you think he said a lawyer? Do you think he said a pilot? He said, I want to be a hafiz of the Quran when I grow up. Subhanallah. This is his life. This is his goal and vision. And because he wants it so much, he's willing to come at 11 p.m., stand for 8 rak'ahs of taraweeh alone without his father. And most children at that age would be scared, standing in a hall full of foreign men. Men that they don't know, people that they don't know, and staying for such a long time. And this was his goal, to grow up to be a hafiz of the Quran. Now that doesn't mean that he can't be a doctor, doesn't mean that he can't be a lawyer. Inshallah, he will grow up to be a very successful young man. Because if he has that determination to be a hafiz of the Quran, then inshallah he will have a similar determination to be successful in his life as well. But look at the difference between the two. Look at the way the two have been given a vision in this life. Look at the way that they are. And this is what we need to revive within our ummah. This is what we need for our ummah. And the place where that starts, and this is the second very important point, that the place where this emanates and starts is in the heart. It is in the heart. And that's why when you look at many of the actions of Islam, you find things like intention, sincerity, hope, fear, love, all of these emotions, they come from the heart, taqwa and so on. All of them emanate from the heart. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, أَلَّا إِنَّ فِي الْجَسَدِ مُضْغَةً إِذَا صَلَحَتْ صَلَحَ الْجَسَدُ كُلُّهُ وَإِذَا فَسَدَتْ فَسَدَ الْجَسَدُ كُلُّهُ أَلَا وَهِيَ الْقَلْبُ. Indeed, within the body, there is a morsel of flesh. There is a part of the body that if it is pure and correct, the rest of the body will follow. And if it is evil and corrupt, then the rest of the body will follow. Indeed, it is the heart. It is the heart. This is where it needs to start. So that a person's relationship with Allah is with a pure heart. Their relationship with their parents comes from a pure heart. Their relationship with their spouse and their children comes from a pure heart. And their relationship with the wider community comes from a pure heart. And when you have this, and you have that vision and that goal that comes from a pure heart, then the sky is truly the limit. The sky is truly the limit. There is a famous story that when Abu Bakr radiallahu anh first became the Khalifa, and as I mentioned in yesterday's lecture, the Muslims had a difficult time during his Khilafah. There were many issues that had to be dealt with. The Romans and the Persians were attacking. The Bedouin tribes were refusing to pay zakah. People were saying that they were new prophets after the Prophet ﷺ. Others were apostating from Islam. He had many issues. So Umar radiallahu anh, he came to Abu Bakr at the beginning of his Khilafah, very early on. And he said, "Oh, Abu Bakr, you have enough problems to deal with. So leave the issues of Medina, the affairs of Medina, leave them to me. I will be your judge. Anyone has a problem, you send them to me. You deal with the Ummah." So Abu Bakr agreed. And so this happened and it continued for 1 year. After a year, Umar radiallahu anh came to Abu Bakr one day. And he said, "Oh, Abu Bakr, I don't want the job anymore. I want to resign from being a judge." So Abu Bakr was amazed. This is Umar. Umar doesn't resign. He doesn't give up from anything. Right? He'll want more, not less. So he was amazed. "Oh Umar, what's wrong? Is it too difficult? Are there too many people? Is it too time consuming? What's wrong?" So Umar radiallahu anhu said, "No. It's not difficult. It's not time consuming. It's not hard. But there's no need for a judge in Medina. For by Allah, for the whole year, not a single case has come to me. Not a single issue has come to me to deal with." Can you imagine living in a community and a society where in a whole year, not one issue has to go to the judge? Now that doesn't mean that there weren't problems. Doesn't mean that there weren't differences. Doesn't mean that there weren't disputes. And that's why Umar radiallahu anh went on and he said, "Because this is an ummah, our community, the Muslims of Medina, they are a group of people, each one of them knows the rights of others upon them. And they know the rights that they have upon others. So they don't go overboard. They don't transgress. They know what's due to them, they know what's due to others. Not only that, but if someone is ill, the community will go and cook food for them. They will visit them. If someone passes away, the community will come together to support that family. If there is a problem, someone's in debt, someone needs some help, the community will rally and they will help them. So there's no need for a judge in Medina, O Abu Bakr." Imagine living in that type of society. Now the companions radiallahu anhum, where did they get this from? How did that happen? It wasn't just something natural. It wasn't just something which they inherited. It was something which they worked on. When they had that vision for themselves, not only did they have that vision, but then they had that high determination. Not only did they have that high determination, but they had a pure heart as well. And then they had sincerity. And that's the next point. That everything that they do for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because there is a fact of life that not everyone will achieve what they set to achieve. You may have high aspirations, you may have a goal, but perhaps by the decree of Allah, you may not achieve that. Yet even so, your efforts will not go unrewarded. Your efforts will not go unrewarded. Even if they're not found out in your time, then inshallah, the people that come after you will benefit from it. Look at Imam al-Bukhari, rahimahullahu ta'ala. Imam al-Bukhari gathered a few thousand hadith in a book, and he made sure that they were all authentic, and that's it. Then he passed away. He didn't know what was going to happen afterwards. He didn't know that a time would come when more or less every single Muslim, over 1 billion strong, would know the name of Bukhari. He could never imagine that a time would come that within every single house, more or less, and every single masjid, there is a copy of his book, Sahih al-Bukhari. Look at that small seed that he sowed. And look at the great fruits that that seed bore many years later on. And even if you don't recognize or you don't find the fruits of your endeavors in this life, then Allah will preserve them for you in the next life. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, سَبَقَ dirham مِئَةُ أَلْفْ dirham. A person gave one dirham, like $1. And it surpassed 100,000 dirhams. They said, O Messenger of Allah, how? He said, because a person only owns two dirhams. That's all he has to his name or to her name. So he spends one in the way of Allah, half of his wealth. And so that person is rewarded for giving half of their wealth. Whereas the other person is very, very extremely wealthy, extremely rich. And for them, that 100,000 is like pocket change. So they give 100,000, but it means nothing to them. So in the sight of Allah, that one dirham is more heavy in the scales than that 100,000. Look at how just Allah is. Look at how merciful Allah is. Look at how kind and generous Allah is. So my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, high determination, high aspirations, they require patience. They require perseverance. They require tawakkul in Allah, trusting in Allah, having certainty in the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But it is something which we need to revive. If we're truly going to make a difference in our generation, and for the generation of our children and our grandchildren, we need to start now. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam never saw how vast this ummah became. He died and the empire was still in the Arabian Peninsula. But within a few years, less than a decade, Islam had spread to the corners of Europe and to the corners of Asia and in Africa, all within a few years. So if we plant the seeds today and now, then inshallah we will see its fruits in our lives. And even if we don't, then inshallah our children and our grandchildren will see those fruits inshallah. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He blesses us and that He gives us the ability to be sources of good, that He gives us the ability to have change and to initiate change within ourselves and within our communities. Jazakumullah khair, you've been a great audience. I've really enjoyed my time in Calgary, and inshallah, there's a brother there that's waving like crazy. He's waving because inshallah I will be back in July for an Al Maghrib Institute course called Risk Factory, which will be studying zakah, fasting and hajj. So inshallah I hope that I will see you in July bi'idhnillah. Jazakumullah khairan wa sallallahu wa sallam ala bin Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.